We're going to start our thematic session on what will sustainable fisheries look like in 2025 now. And so this session really is a chance for our speakers to present a bit of their research and then kind of speculate a little bit based on that data and their previous work, what they think some of the big issues affecting fisheries will be over the next decade or so. And so this follows on very nicely from the plenary we heard before the break from Daniel Pawley. So our first speaker who's going to give us our plenary talk is Michael Kaiser. So Michael, if you want to come up, and he's going to be talking about integrating conservation and fisheries objectives in special areas of conservation. Thank you.
Hopefully the talk will appear any moment, or do I have to hit the next button? No. So if we could have my talk, that'd be great. Please? Anytime? Soon? Well, just while they're loading up my talk, hopefully. Also, so good morning. Thanks very much for the invitation to be here. And I'm going to pick up on some of the points that Daniel Pawley raised in his plenary, where he talked about the fact that fishing trawling, particularly trawling activities or any sort of towed mobile bottom fishing gears have a potential to affect marine ecosystems, and that's very clearly understood, but it's also clearly understood that those effects vary depending on where those impacts actually occur. So I'm going to try and illustrate. Good morning, so there we are. So I'm going to try and illustrate some of those points using some long-term studies we've done in special areas of conservation, effectively their marine protected areas. And what I actually want to do in this talk, so first of all, I'm going to look at Lyme Bay SAC in the UK, and that's a 10-year study. Then we're going to look at a contrasting area, Cardigan Bay SAC, and that's a 5-year study. So these are both really clearly quite long periods of time that we've been looking at these areas. But in the context of marine protected areas, I actually want to conclude my talk by really considering the opportunities that conservation zones, MPAs or marine reserves can actually offer us to change the way that we actually fish, because they actually provide a very strong legislative framework, which means that we can have the opportunity to do things in a very different way that is very focused towards maintaining the conservation or the biodiversity status, while also attempting to harvest sustainably within those areas as well. And I'll try and illustrate that by some work we've been doing in the Isle of Man, together with the Manx government, and also the Manx fishing industry, where we're sort of gradually moving more towards a territorial user rights system, which really acts to promote behaviours that reduce negative effects on the marine environment. So hopefully I'll get there in good order, because I think that's the most exciting bit of my talk. So here we have Lyme Bay Special Area of Conservation. There's a little bit of history around this. First of all, the special area of conservation is designated for its main features, of course, a limestone rocky reef, so very stable substratum, very stable habitats, and these are associated with quite high biodiversity or biodiverse marine ecosystems. And in particular, there is one species which is protected under European and UK legislation, and that's the pink sea fan, which is a type of gorgonian. And the timeline around this particular story is prior to 2006, Lyme Bay was open to fishing, but the fishing was not homogeneously distributed across that area. There are quite substantial areas within Lyme Bay which are quite frankly unfishable using towed fishing gear simply because of the topography of the seabed. And so what that does is it creates, if you like, a nice heterogeneous landscape with areas which have been exposed to chronic fishing and those areas which have not been exposed to fishing. And then because of environmental focus on this particular area and lobbying to have a large closure put in place, the fishing industry agreed, I think somewhat reluctantly, but eventually, to set up the four boxes that you see within the main box, which are were voluntary closures. And these operated for a 12-month period. And then subsequent to that, I think the fishing industry were hoping that that would be enough to calm down the environmental groups. But eventually, the UK government designated the larger box that you see as the conservation zone. And as a result, towed mobile fishing gear was excluded from 2000, just after late in 2007 onwards. So, but fishing has still continued within that area, but it's only using static fishing gears, which have relatively low environmental impact. What we were able to do was, knowing that these voluntary areas were about to be put in place, we were able to do a before sampling event, and you see all our sample stations scattered around Lyme Bay. And then after the voluntary areas have been implemented, we were able to do post sampling, so then a year later. And then earlier this year, I went together with two MSc students from Bangor University, and we resurveyed all these sites again. So that's some 10 years, nine, 10 years since the beginning of this whole story actually commenced. And it's quite nice. So the way the sample design is actually arranged is that we have replicate samples in areas which have never been fished because of their topography. We also had chart plotter data from the fishing industry so we could see exactly where they had fished in the past. So we knew that there were some areas within the voluntary areas which had previously been fished. And then we knew there were areas outside in the wider SAC that had also not been fished previously because they were unsuitable, unsafe to fish. But also we could identify areas which had been fished chronically as well. So we had this nice combination of fished areas, unfished areas, both within and out with voluntary protected areas. And then latterly, of course, we've been able to look at recovery after 10 years. So it's quite a nice sort of natural experiment and well replicated. So how did we do this? Well, all this sampling was done using underwater photographic techniques. So we're towing neutrally buoyant sledges. And you see some photographs of the key organisms that I'm going to talk about. So we've got pink sea fans in panel A and good job, I'm squinting with my eyesight here. Ah, yes, we've got dead men's fingers in panel B. Then we've got Ross corals, which are actually bryozoans, in panel C. We've got emergent sponges in panel D and large sea squirts in panel E. And we also have some commercial species, so obviously scallops and things like edible crabs and spider crabs as well. And these were the key organisms that we looked at, because they are emergent, they're large, and hence you would expect them to be vulnerable to towed mobile fishing gear. Now, with such a large gap between sampling events, it's really important that you actually double check that you've actually sampled the same type of environments on both occasions, on all three occasions in effect. So this histogram in the bottom panel basically just shows you a distribution of the habitat types that we surveyed both in 2007 and then in 2010. There was only one slight, very minor difference. We sampled a little bit more gravel habitat, with a very, very small percentage increase of gravel habitat in our sampling in 2016 this year, but it really is a very, very small difference. So effectively, we haven't introduced a habitat effect in our sampling design. So the key thing is then, you would expect, you remove tow mobile fishing gear, you would expect there to be large changes in the abundance of many of the emergent and sensitive species. So what these panels show you is the difference between the abundance per unit area, plus or minus standard error, of some of the species that I've mentioned. For 2007, they're the black bars, and 2016, they are the open bars. And yes, indeed, not surprisingly, we saw some significant changes in abundance, but not necessarily for the species you might think. So dead men's fingers, which is a type of soft coral, they uniformly increased across all treatment types. Although, interestingly, the in the areas which had never been fished and had always been protected, actually there is no significant change there, and they were always higher, actually, the Alcyonium digitatum were always highest within those areas. But overall, a uniform increase in abundance. Then also we saw for some of the fishing treatments, not fish treatments, an increase in abundance for the large sea squirts, Fallusia mammillata. But what we didn't see was a significant change in the abundance of the other species, such as the pink sea fans. They were still in the same proportions across the treatments that we saw previously, as were Ross corals as well. Pectin maximus, just as abundant as they were previously, and actually a slight decline in the smaller queen scallop species. I'll explain more about that a little bit later. The thing that's really, really interesting, though, in Lyme Bay is that across the board, pretty much, with one exception, and that's for queen scallops, the body size of these animals has increased very substantially. So pink sea fans, Unicella varicosa, it's a long-lived species. You can see right across the board, in all our treatments, whether they were fished previously or not, they have all grown and achieved a similar sort of large size on average across our areas. Similarly, our dead men's fingers have attained a large size and pretty uniformly across all treatments, whether fished or unfished. And also, although there was no increase in the abundance of scallops, which were already quite high anyway, we see that the size of scallops has grown, and king scallops are quite a long-lived species, living up to 15 years. The species that hasn't changed actually in size are queen scallops, and this is a much shorter lived species, so typically they live maybe 6 or 7 years. So within the period of the recovery trajectory of the closed area, we have actually had plenty of time for turnover in that population, for mortality, natural mortality to occur, and this particular species is quite sporadic in terms of its recruitment. It's well known for that, for having that life history strategy. Now, although we didn't see in those bar plots significant increases in abundance, when we do that type of comparison for some of the species we would expect, if we actually increase the power of our analysis by pooling much of our data together, we can generate these recovery plots. Now, the way we've done this is we've taken the abundance of the animals that were within the areas that had never been exposed to fishing, and we've plotted their means, which you see in the red dots, so we've got four replicate treatments there, plotted their means, and basically we're using that as our benchmark of K, or the carrying capacity for those species in that system. And then because of the timeline history of Lyme Bay, with the voluntary closures being brought into place and then the whole area being closed afterwards, we're able to create a number of points along a recovery time trajectory, which you see are the blue points, and these were the areas that previously had been exposed to fishing. And we can actually, by pooling all our data together, you can see some quite nice interesting relationships there. So the ones that I would highlight, you see in the middle at the top there, Alcyonium digitatum, these dead men's fingers, they appear to have recovered, actually, if you look at where that line intercepts our projected carrying capacity line, roughly after about 60 or 70 months or so. Now, that's not surprising. These are quite a fast-growing species, and they're quite generalist. They don't require bedrock to actually live on. They'll grow on pretty much anything, like small pebbles and shells and things like this. And they've just settled all over the area. So lots of dead men's fingers, and they recolonize very quickly. King scallops, not surprisingly, pretty much recovered, almost certainly have recovered. And those sort of timescales in most other marine protected area studies that we look at, after about 5 years, you see these very large increases in the abundance of king scallops. So perhaps no surprising there. What is interesting, more interesting though, is our pink sea fans. Recovery trajectory is certainly present, but there's still some way to go. So maybe potentially another 5 years or so before we see full recovery there. And also for things like the Ross corals, the Pentapora facialis, which you see in the middle at the bottom. Now, once we have these sort of recovery plots, that's really important because we can start understanding what sort of timescales we can expect these species to recover over, and that really helps to inform management. Now I'm going to take you very quickly to Cardigan Bay SAC, which is very different. So Lyme Bay, of course, very much bedrock dominated, very stable substratum type, supporting lots of long-lived species. Now Cardigan Bay SAC in Wales, again, a large area. This area is nearly 300 square kilometres, this box, off the coast of Cardigan Bay, designated for, in terms of habitat features, cobble reefs. But it turns out, it transpires that the majority of the cobble reefs are actually within the 3 nautical mile zone of the coast, so from 0 to 3 nautical miles off. And from 3 nautical miles out to the 12 nautical mile zone, which is the edge of the box, the seaward edge of the box, there's very little evidence that there are any cobble reefs there whatsoever because of the extensive work that we've done. The entire area was closed to scallop dredging back in 2009. So you see the timeline history of what happened here. So in 2008, 2009, there was a large increase in scallop dredging activity due to a very heavy settlement of scallops. This led to complaints by environmental NGOs to the European Commission. The Welsh government was then threatened with infraction and put an emergency stop order on all fishing to allow additional evidence about the features of the site to be gathered. That work was then done and published in a report. A small piece of the area, which is this Kaiser box, is the only thing I've ever had named after me. It's a box, it's not very illustrious, is it? So was reopened, and that basically is a highly mobile sand wave system within there, which ecologically you would expect to be more resilient to disturbance. That then led to extensive monitoring thereafter. And finally, because there was interest in seeing whether it was appropriate to open any other parts of the area to scallop dredging, we undertook an experiment. And the whole purpose of this experiment, and it's the world's largest manipulation of fishing disturbance undertaken to date, the whole purpose of the experiment was to try and establish thresholds, conservation thresholds, for disturbance. In other words, so that you could base your management not so much on the target species, which is what Daniel Pawley was talking about before, but actually it's the conservation features and damage to the conservation features, or limiting that with a threshold that you're actually managing to. So this is what the experiment looked like. This is another box next door to the Kaiser box, and we laid out across this area 17 boxes. They're pretty large. They're 1.7 kilometers by nearly 400 meters wide. And these boxes were 4 control boxes, and the other boxes were fished at a gradient of different fishing intensities. And in order to achieve that, we had to charter commercial fishing boats to do that operation. And all of this had to be risk assessed based on scientific evidence which we gathered, which again demonstrated there were no cobble reef features out in this area, because clearly if you do an experiment that damages the features in the special area of conservation, that's illegal. And so having been given the green light to do that, we tendered for vessels which had to fish at predetermined intensities of fishing. And in the purple areas, to the right of the diagram as you look, that's a very zoomed out shot of the GPS plots that we got back from the fishing vessels. So we had second by second recording of exactly where they were fishing. They could only fish within these boxes and at these predetermined intensities. And so this is a huge experiment. One of the most complicated things I've ever done, especially when you're having to deal with fishermen and commercial tenders and things like this. But just some basic statistics for you. So we had 5 boats. Between them all, they were using 50 dredges in total. That equated to nearly 1,100 hours of fishing. And in terms of dredge hours, that's per dredge, that's 12,000 dredge hours of fishing. Landing nearly 8,000 bags of scallops, and after they've been shucked, that ends up as nearly 30 tons of meat in Waitrose for people to buy. The revenue generated from those landings could only be used to pay the fees. So this, the fees based on the tender process to the fishermen, which was £250,000, near enough. And the amount that was left over was then spent on processing lots of buckets of worms using commercial external contractors. So no money went to our university. We just acted as a clearinghouse for that. So what we've actually tried to do with all this data then is actually define thresholds beyond which the system within Cardigan Bay starts to sustain or go beyond thresholds of damage, if you like. And that's what you see in these diagrams. So you see there's a stepped line fitted to the top upper panels, and I'll just show the graphs only for Dead Men's Fingers, because we talked about Dead Men's Fingers before in Lyme Bay. They're actually very sparse in Cardigan Bay, simply because this is such a dynamic and very energetic environment. But we can, with our experimental design, detect and specify thresholds of disturbance. And so basically, using this approach, what one could advise the government is that you do not want to allow fishing activity that goes beyond this amount of disturbance to the seabed, because beyond that amount of disturbance, you will start to sustain negative effects on these species, which will take a considerable period of time for recovery to actually occur. If we can then actually break down and look at this on a species by species basis, so all you need to know is there's a big long list of different individual species that we've looked at, and we've looked at both abundance and biomass of those species. Now, the first graph on the left as you look at it, this basically is the relative change in response to fishing, both before and after. So before and then 1 month after the experiment was actually undertaken. So there are the means and error bars in red. And then comparing before to 4 months later. So we had a recovery sampling date as well, and that's in blue. The graph, which I think is more important in this particular context is the one on the right as you look at it, because this is looking at the relative change that occurred in the natural communities in the control areas. And we can see that using those same temporal comparisons, there's some very large natural changes that actually occur within those systems. There are natural decreases which occur in those systems, and in some cases there are increases as well. So very, very large scale of natural variability in the system, because overall species abundance and diversity is very, very low in this environment. It's complete contrast to Lyme Bay SAC. Now, we often talk about biology, and unfortunately we often talk about biology in the absence of talking about the physics. Well, you can't talk about biology without thinking about physical oceanography. And it's physics in this system that really dominates. This is an acoustic image of the seabed. These are mega ripple sand systems which are literally moving, because we have temporal monitoring of these sand systems. They literally move across the seabed. So they're covering and uncovering different parts of the substratum at different times in the year. So anything that lives here in the main is going to be adapted to an environment which is pretty mobile, and hence many of the species tend to be quite ephemeral and opportunistic. Just to illustrate how ephemeral and how disturbed that environment can be, well, this is not an ephemeral species, but this is the North Wales coast. Just a month ago, photographs sent to me by a member of the general public. This clam that you see burrows down to 20 centimetres in the sediment. All that fuzzy stuff on the beach that you see there, they are tons and tons and tons of clams, which basically have been thrown up by the storm activity that actually occurred over 2 days last month. So it really does sort of emphasise in certain systems how important physical processes are. So, but that's, you know, to marine biologists, that's nothing really very dramatic. Some systems are highly perturbed, others are not, and communities in those systems differ for that reason, as does their resilience and vulnerability. So where does that take us? So Cardigan Bay is really very interesting, because there we're thinking about, is it possible to have a fishery? How can we manage that better? How can we manage that in a way that is very much focused at managing two conservation targets, not fishery targets? Well, We're actually already doing this in the Isle of Man, but by default. And what the Isle of Man government has done, because the Isle of Man has exclusive jurisdiction around the waters, around the island, which you see in the middle panel there, out to 12 nautical miles offshore, they implemented a conservation zone in Ramsey Bay, which is at the north end of the island. And you see it there highlighted in grey, and then there's a black box highlighted as well. So there are some really quite sensitive features in there. There's merl, seagrass, things like this, completely incompatible with towed fishing gear. But also, there's a fishery management zone, which is a lease that has been given to the local producer organisation, and they are allowed to fish that, but with the input of scientific advice. And so highlighted within the potential fishery management zone, which you see here in purple, is a small area. So after scientific survey, we identified after a closure of 5 years that there were high densities of scallops across the area, but the highest densities were in that box that's highlighted in red. And so that was going to be reopened, and a quota was set. And basically, because it was a territorial user rights system, the PO chartered two boats to actually do that fishing. And the result of that was they didn't fish the entire area. To actually get their quota, they fished that rash of red that you see in the middle. So by setting a quota in an area that's been allowed to achieve high densities again leads to highly efficient fishing. When you actually analyse this in energetic terms, then you compare the landings per unit effort in Ramsey Bay, where they're fishing this turf, to the island-wide statistics. So in Ramsey Bay, in panel A, you see it's in black, very high landings per unit effort. Outside, where the activity is less strictly controlled, you see the landings per unit effort very low. So that's a really powerful statement. Fuel intensity, incredibly low, highly efficient. So if you look at energy return on investment, EROI, you see in Ramsey Bay, it becomes, and this is what Daniel Pawley said, we've been throwing fossil fuels at fisheries, but you can actually turn that story around. And then more interesting still, if you compare the energy return on investment to other forms of terrestrial-based food production, like beef lock, cattle production, pig production, and egg production, you see the EROI for scallops in a territorial user rights system, which has conservation as part of that plan, actually becomes more efficient way of producing protein. So in terms of 2025, I think the point I wanted to highlight was actually conservation zones, which fishermen often see as a negative, have really quite exciting potentials because of the strict and very strong legislative framework that protect them. They allow you to do things differently in ways that you could not normally approach fisheries in the current world. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. That was an excellent talk. I think we have time for one or two quick questions. If anyone would like to ask. Do you want to just come up to one of the microphones or shout?
Absolutely not, and people get very nervous about it because if you have user rights, that means that somebody doesn't have use rights as well. I think it's one of those situations where actually, by demonstrating that it works, it's actually very helpful. So that's why I'm so excited about this particular study, because I think then when you can actually put that on the table, and people see the benefit of how that actually works. And actually, it's not just one benefit, it's dual benefit as well. And I think the only positive thing I can personally say about Brexit is that it may be easier now for the UK to perhaps think about moving towards these sort of systems. Yeah.
One more quick question? No? Okay, thanks
very much.
So up next we have Andrea Belgrano talking about fish out of water, a macroecological perspective.
Okay, thanks a lot. And
Hopefully this talk links very well with the last words of Mike Began this morning. So we have to get rid of the fact that we think that we're going to have the truth with big T. We're just going to make ways to reach little truth on the way to the big truth. So we have to get rid of our ability to give facts and theory and be always try to be exact. We should learn maybe more from the hearts, how to perform and be more communicative with the public. So my talk today is gonna try to touch on these things. So the sea has been always a kind of inspirational place for many people. But when you scratch the surface, oh, something wrong here. There's one slide missing, I don't know why. Anyway, it's complex. Doesn't seem to work. Yeah.
So if you press the right button,
yeah.
That should.
Okay. But I want to go back. So this, okay. Well, anyway, marine ecosystems are adaptive, are complex systems, and have emergent properties, and you can see the productive area around the globe. So when you scratch the surface, there are structures like marine food webs. Doesn't go. Oh, no. Okay. Like marine food web, which are, in this picture, there are three different ecosystems, and we are looking at the topology of the food webs, and there are some common characteristic of the food web is the connectedness, how these different webs from different ecosystems are actually connected, how species are actually connected in this trophic interaction. And you can see the connecting terms, C, is pretty much similar in the three systems. So some kind of universality explaining how these webs are coming together. And when you look at the effect of fishery, just to give you a quick example, this is the exploitation pattern of Atlantic cod on the Swedish west coast. And the first panel is like at the beginning of the century. And as you move towards the last decade, 2000 up to 2007, you can see that the local coastal population have been actually exploited. So the outline of my talk, I will just give you a brief overview of macroecology and how we can use it to study marine ecosystem and fishery. And then I will touch about management issues and how we can link macroecological perspective to socioeconomic resilience, fishery and ecosystem services. So macroecology, I like to use this cartoon from a French writer where he puts to define macroecology, basically when you look things under the microscope, and you put the microscope to study the infinitely complex, so where's nature and society meet, which is the case for fishery. So to understand really fishery, you just don't have to look at the ecology, but also to study the social interaction which are related to the fishery. So macroecology in itself can be a unified ecological concept which study large-scale problems and have a statistical approach to question about abundance distribution and biodiversity, is using allometric scaling as a mechanistic approach to draw correlation between distribution of species and species trait like body size. And species area relationships is also part of a macroecological approach, which goes back to the 1920s, where kind of try to understand the species richness in terms of the sampled areas. One of the classic correlation or allometric scaling in macroecology is the body mass on the x-axis and the numerical abundance on the y. This is an example going from trees, forest, to marine phytoplankton. And it seems this is allometric scaling or n to the m to the minus 3/4 is holding in different system. So how can we use this kind of thinking in fishery science and ecology? As I show you the previous relationship, it can be used, this organism size and abundance, to question how a change in the slope might be connected to different aspects like environmental change, species invasion, exploitation, life fishery, change in the management, and so on. So the question is, can we actually use this macroecological approach as a universal indicators for looking how fishery has been impacted? So just to give an idea of the social aspect of fishery, it's good to go to visit to Japan. And here's the fish market in Tokyo, the tuna auction. This is a frozen tuna, and this is the cycle. The fresh tuna, they give a price looking at the quality of the meat from the tail. Then the fish is sold, and then he ends up in the squeezy restaurant in Kyoto and Tokyo, where he serves a sashimi. So basically, you have to understand patterns, and going back to the question of big fish, like this is a Dutch painting of the 1600s, so that's probably when there was a lot of large fish in the North Sea. It's not the case right now. So if you look at the FAO statistics, which was also previously shown and talked about by Daniel Pauli, basically you can see that the wild catch is kind of level up towards the 2010. And what is definitely increasing is aquaculture, marine aquaculture and fresh water aquaculture, which is actually making the total landings going up in this plot. So when it comes to fishery, of course, they've been using in modern fishery models to look at fish stocks. And I would like to give you a second to guess what was the structuring variables that was chosen for the stock assessment model. Well, it's definitely age. So size, although is important, is not really made a major role up to the last decade in fishery assessment models. So what kind of models you can use by kind of trying to include this macroecological approach? Obviously, you can question body size, abundance, and the geographical distribution of fish species. And you can see in this graph that large species tend to be having a larger geographical distribution, and you have larger body size fish, and then you have smaller fish, which has a smaller geographical distribution and tend to be more abundant. So this is something to take into consideration. And then in a conceptual model, you have the macroecological aspect like body size, abundance, species richness, geographical range size that need to be actually considered if you want to have a much broader view how my fishery and environmental process will influence different stocks. In this picture, one thing that is still not really well answered, in the panel A, you have a change in the slope, and the slope becomes shallower when you have large organism. In panel B, you have the distribution of large cell marine phytoplankton. We tend to be in the north, where the letter A is, in the North Atlantic, and smaller size where the letter B off the Chilean coast. And then in the panel C, you have where the large fish body size are found, which seems to be correlating very well with the large phytoplankton cell. So how this pattern actually came about is still kind of not very clear. So this is something that we should pay attention in the future. And this is also a graph showing the percentage change in catch according to the trophic level. And one striking picture is the one for the North Atlantic, where you tend to have always a larger body size fish, difference from the global average between 40 to 84 centimeters. But there's been a tremendous decrease in the catch of the apex predator in the North Atlantic. So this is a kind of pattern for different large marine ecosystems. Another aspect that is important to consider is the evolutionary influence of fishing selectivity. And here, basically, on the panel B, if you have a pressure from fishery on large size fish, so mortality is added, when you release this pressure, in ecological terms, the fish stock should kind of go up again, and you should have more large fish coming up, maturing older age. Instead, because of this evolutionary effect, you have a truncated population structure, so you have early maturation fish, yeah, and you have a problem in recovering the stocks. So I now move to management, just to give an example that is, seems to be positive. So the management is always a wrestling between scientists, stakeholders, and the politics. And I give an example going back to the Swedish coast, where we use a species area relationship theory, SAR, and we were interesting to look at the changes in the slope Z. So you rearrange this equation, and you can use a species accumulation curve, where you look at changes in the slope Z. So we were looking at changes in the community status as an indicator to try to link to the socioeconomic resilience of the Swedish west coast, and we look at the SAR slope, large fish index, and the mean trophic level. We use a survey, scientific surveys from offshore and the coastal area in connection with the trawling band limitation and the marine protected area, for marine protected area in Sweden, to see if the effects of governance from putting enforcement with the trawl limit and the implementation of the marine protected area had an effect on the fish community development. As you can see from the graph, when you look at the SAR, there's been an increase in the species richness in both coastal and offshore area. And when you look at the slope in the panel A, we can see that there has been a positive increase after the enforcement and the implementation of the marine protected area. In the LFI, there was not any significant increase in the large fish index. And the mean trophic level, we also saw an increase in the mean trophic level, both in the offshore and in the coastal area. So indicating that the combination of having a macro ecological approach and implementing governance and MPA results in a beneficial development of the fish community along the Swedish west coast. Just to finish off, a couple of slides more. So this is what we have to do in the future, try to link fishery and ecosystem services. We have all these ecological realms, food webs, fishery, genetics, whatever, and also indigenous and local knowledge, and you have different ecosystem services. And if you have this approach, looking at the ecology and socioeconomic outcomes like Ostrom approach and governance, so the question mark is, where are we going in the future? One example is also looking at development in the technical side of fishery. This is a clean catch of the shrimp trawler on the Swedish west coast, where they have a special equipment to just catch shrimps and not catch many of the other bycatch species. Basically, I kind of an advocate of a multi-species approach and tropodynamics models approach to marine fishery. I think this will be something to look for the future. Thank you.
We've got time for one quick question, if anyone wants to. Any questions? No? Okay, thank you. Thanks. So up next, we have John Pinniger from CFAS talking about North Sea fisheries and climate change.
Okay, can we have the slide? There we go, jolly good. I'm going to talk a little bit about whether or not the trends in the species that we're seeing showing up at our fishing ports and in our surveys now are really sort of prescient of what we're expecting to see in the next 10, 20 years or so. First thing to note is that the North Sea, which is up there-ish, has been highlighted as a hot spot of climate change. It's one of 20 that Hobday and Peckel suggested was one of the areas of the world that's warmed the quickest. So, okay, should be a thing flying in, yes, okay. This is just a slide really showing the North Sea temperature time series. So these are a number of stations from Norway, the blue one, all the way up to Dover, the pink one. And you can see that over the last century,
there really has been quite a big temperature increase, particularly at the end of the time series, although there's been wobbles over the period. Related to that, there's been quite a few high-profile papers using our data at CFAS to note that there's been changes in the fish community. 70% of fish species have responded, at least in some way, to warming, whether that's changing their distribution or their abundance. Their centres of gravities have shifted within the North Sea by up to, well, several hundred miles. 403 kilometres. Also, the communities, on average, it's deepened as well. So because the north-south gradient in the North Sea is related to depth, basically fish are moving downhill to find cooler temperatures. Come on. There we go. One of the benefits of working where I work is that the lab was established in 1902, so 114 years ago, and it floats on a raft of paper. Our basement is absolutely chock-a-block with paper. We have amazing time series going back over that period. We've been monitoring fish coming into the UK ports over that time period. Also, we have our own research vessel, and we've had vessels since 1902. So the Huxley was our first vessel, and the first thing it did was surveying fish populations in the North Sea. This little picture here shows one of our early fishery scientists wearing a bowler hat at Lowestoft Harbour, monitoring the fish catches. When you have that sort of data, you can try and string together time series. And what this shows, this is a chart. This is one of 37,000 charts that we found in the basement that we've started to digitise. And for every rectangle on this chart, there's the tonnage landed and the effort that went into it. And we have these for every month of the year from 1913, pretty much up to the present day. So using that, you can start to look at spatial time series of where the fish are moving and where they're going. Based on that, this is an analysis that we published in 2011. Something screwy's happened. But each one of these is a decade. And you can see that in the 1920s, this is place were very much concentrated in the bottom of the North Sea here on the Netherlands coast throughout much of the time series. But then in the last few years, they've generally shifted offshore. They're moving sort of northwestwards. We've done the same thing for cod, and they're moving northeastwards. All of the species move in slightly different directions, but it allows us to get an idea of long-term time series and figure out where the species are moving. Generally, most species are moving northwards. This is just the same thing expressed in a different way. So it's showing the latitude and longitude and then the depth. And you can see that over the 100-year time period, place have generally moved northwards. They were pretty stable, but then they've suddenly lurched to the west after about the 1990s. And they've generally been moving deeper, which we interpret as both an influence of both climate change and fishing. Another thing that we have is we have 114 years of research survey data. So the little maps here show all the stations for each of our research vessels. These are photos of the vessels here. We've been monitoring both the size and the abundance of the different species, and we've noticed very strong subtropicalization of species in the North Sea. We're getting more warm water species coming in, and also generally with a smaller body size, which reflects some of the things we've heard already. And I'll go through some examples of this in a moment. One example that I've been talking to the BBC about all morning is squid, and we heard a little bit about it from Daniel's talk earlier. We published a paper in, that should be 2016, not 2006, where we looked at the survey catches for the last 30-odd years, and we found there's been a massive increase in squid in the North Sea. They were only present in 20% of our stations in the 1980s, but they're now present in about 60% of our stations. Small-scale fisheries have generally opened up, particularly off the coast of Scotland, and it's largely a result as the fishermen switching because they don't have the opportunities given that there's been very tight controls on fishing for cod and haddock. And so it's seen as a new opportunity that they can use as a sort of alternative to their traditional species. This is quite a nice little press article that came out in January this year talking about the squid fishery. But it is very much a summer squid fishery that's seen as a means of the fishermen to diversify their income. Cod has often been sort of quoted as, if you like, a poster child of climate change. According to the most recent population estimate, stock assessment of cod, which is what's illustrated down here, the population, it was very heavily fished after about the 1980s. You can see these are the catches here. But then also, there was very heavy decommissioning schemes to remove effort from the fishery. So fishing mortality has actually declined over the last 10 or so years. And you can see there's been a little bit of a recovery in the cod stock in the North Sea, so that now they're at a level that we would consider sustainable fishing. However, if you also look at the level of recruitment, so this is the number of juveniles coming into the population, you see that over the last 10 years, it's been pretty flat and pretty low. So that means that this has taken much longer to recover than we would have liked and we would have thought previously. So as our climate projections suggest that the warming of the North Sea will continue, and so maybe we'll expect this sort of low level of recruitment to continue into the future. So cod will still be there in the future, but we might have to be a bit more careful about the way we manage them. But what most people in Britain don't realise is that we get 90% of our cod from countries further north anyway. We have been doing ever since the 1930s, buying it from Iceland and Norway. And we still do that, but now, rather than going there to fish it ourselves, we just buy it off the Norwegians and the Icelanders. So cod will still be on the menus of our fish and chip shops. We've also seen quite big changes in the distribution of mackerel. In 2009, mackerel seemed to start moving away from Norway into the centre of the North Sea. And then after that, they moved over towards Iceland and the Faroe Islands, and those countries declared a quota, having never had a quota before. So they unilaterally decided that quite rightly, that they would exploit the fish in their waters. EU countries got a bit upset about that and accused them of threatening sustainability. And this is the sort of thing that we expect a lot more of as species move around as the temperature warms up. This is just one example of an interaction between the fish distribution, the temperature, sometimes to do with the plankton availability as well. Another example is anchovy in the channel. Anchovy have been recently very depleted in the Bay of Biscay, their traditional area, but they've been showing up in very large numbers in the channel in the southern North Sea. A study in 2012 showed that actually the fish that are in the southern North Sea are not the same fish. They're a small population that has always been there but is suddenly expanded. And the reason that makes a difference is that at the moment, Spanish and French vessels have exclusive access to the anchovy fishery under the rules of the Common Fisheries Policy. But if they're not the same genetic line, they're not necessarily granted exclusive access. So it's another example of strange political things happening with the redistribution of species. Given that we've seen all of these changes, how do we try and predict in the future what might happen? Well, we've been doing quite a lot of work trying to predict the distribution using bioclimate envelope models. And what you do with this is you start with your observed distributions of species now. You get various data layers of temperature and depth and salinity and all those sorts of things. And you put those together into a modeling package, sort of Maxent or Biomap or GLMs or GARP. There's loads of them. You can then predict the habitat suitability now. And you can do the same thing if you get these middle data layers from climate models for the future as well. And so we've been trying to do this for a whole range of commercial species to predict what's going to happen to species around the UK. This is just an example. So these are the temperature projections into the future, the bottom temperature and the surface temperature. And this is an example of a common skate. You can't really see a lot of difference, but there's a lot more up here actually than there was there. But we've done this for about 30, 40 species now. And these are the results you get. So, okay, this is our list of commercial species. I've just highlighted a few there. You can see that all of them are projected to move in the future by around 200 kilometers over the next 50 or so years. Some of them move faster than others. So, for example, John Dory, which is a warm water species, is projected to move quite a long way. Other species are not moving so far. But notice all of them, even the cold water species, are projected to move. The difference is whether they're moving towards us or away from us. So another way you can express this is, I don't know sure if you can read this, but this is from a report. We looked at the projected abundance inside the UK EEZ. And the species at the top of here are species that we project are going to sort of be winners, and the species towards the bottom will be the losers. And you can see that squid is the one that's moving the fastest and the furthest. So the projections are that it's going to increase by about 31% over the next 50 years and move by about 445 kilometers. Cod is down here. The range of the model outputs spans zero, and so we're not sure whether or not they're going to go up or down. But these species further down, so herring and mackerel and halibut, are probably going to, they'll still be present in UK waters, but not in as larger numbers. So, okay, so ask the question, what will sustainable fisheries look like in 2025? Generally, I'm optimistic that many of our sort of traditional fish stocks, such as cod and haddock and plaice, will still be around the UK in 2025, but we will require very careful management to keep them there because of the low level of recruitment. However, populations will not necessarily be able to sustain the same level of fishing pressure as they've previously been able to sustain. However, small-scale fisheries that we're seeing now, such as those focused on squid or sardine or anchovy, I expect to expand quite a lot over the next 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. Finally, one thing that I think we should think about is a large proportion of the fish that citizens eat in the UK are actually imported, mostly from countries further north. And I think that's a legitimate response to climate change. Buy from places further north the things that you're used to eating. But also, we sell pretty much everything that we catch, mackerel and nepherops and all scallops and all that, to countries further south in Portugal and Spain. So, if you like, there's a little bit of a mismatch between what we eat and what we catch in the UK. So I would argue that a rebalancing of consumer tastes is needed, and that citizens should broaden their diets to include these more Mediterranean species in addition to their traditional favourites. And that should be it.
Thank you. That was excellent. We've got time for one or two quick questions. Yeah. Do you want to just shout loudly?
Yeah, so we've got body size, particularly from the survey data, and generally we have seen things on average get smaller. So both the actual size of animals within the same species, but also at the beginning of the 1900s, there were more species that got bigger. So for example, if you look at the diversity of species that make up the large fish indicator, it was maybe 20, 30 species at the beginning of the 1900s. Now it's predominantly a saithe and cod index. So. Yeah, I mean, in the paper about plaice, we look at both, because we have these historic patterns, data on where the fishing is as well. For some species, it comes out very clearly that both influence them. But with the long time series, you can try and tease it apart a bit. So there have been periods when it's been warm and the fishing has been high, or it's been warm and the fishing has been low. And so that's what we're trying to do, but it's never easy. And I agree, it's almost impossible to fully them apart.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. So next up we have Julia Blanchard talking about fishing and the recycling of energy in a changing ocean. Julia.
Okay, so sometimes what you plan to do when you're trying to meet the abstract deadline is a little different than what you've actually done. So the title of my talk is different, and it's actually a much wider, more integrative study, which I thought was more relevant also to this session. So I'm talking about fisheries at the nexus of food production, biodiversity, and climate change. And so this work is motivated by our collective need to address 17 sustainable development goals to make human development on the planet much more sustainable in the context of ecological sustainability, as well as social and economics. Now, this framework is incredibly integrative and captures all of those components. But one of the things that is often lacking in looking at fisheries and marine fisheries is a lack of integration with what's happening on land and vice versa. And you can see this even in the figure here, which has goal 14 separated from goal 15, so life below water, life on land. And it's been recognized that actually what we really need to do is understand the interactions among all of these goals as well as their targets. But what we also need to do is integrate the interactions across sectors and across ecosystems on land and sea to better understand the trade-offs and cumulative impacts. So this is a very preliminary step, but it's kind of aiming to start doing that. I've put the no tweets sign up there because it's mostly unpublished work. Of course, feel free to tweet, just not so much the photographs of the unpublished work. So what have we been doing? We've been examining the current and future role of fisheries for a wide variety of objectives. Food production in the context of biodiversity loss and sustainability. Climate change and how we can actually adapt to climate change as societies. How is this done? First of all, what we're doing is synthesizing lots of different open global databases, which are great, from various sources. Recent global climate change model outputs that I've been involved in a huge project called Intersectoral Impacts Model Intercomparison Project, or ISIMIP for short, which has recently been extended to include the marine fisheries sector, as well as agriculture and many other sectors on land, and of course the literature. So I'm going to focus mostly on some of the data compilations that we've been looking at so far. So first of all, fish are very much on the menu. They've been on the menu for quite some time, and they're the sector with the greatest production compared to other animal food sectors. So much higher than cattle, chicken, pig, or sheep, and also expanding at a rate that's similar to that of chicken, but a bit higher. Now, as Andrea and others, including Daniel Polly as well, have shown you this trend over time and the fact that this recent expansion is really due to the incredible expansion of aquaculture. So you can see that marine fisheries have kind of stagnated since the 1990s. This is actually all capture production, wild fish caught, compared to this increase in aquaculture. Now, if we try to think about that pattern at a country level, which we need to do to think about some of these goals, we ask the question, so where is that aquaculture coming from? And by compiling information from both freshwater and aquaculture data, as well as information from reconstructed catches, so marine freshwater information there, we can start looking at the balance of aquaculture versus wild capture fisheries. And so, in the EEZs here, we've plotted the wild capture marine fisheries, and on land, we've plotted the sources of the production in terms of aquaculture. And you can see that there's a lot of variation in this map. Most of the blue on land, the really dark blue on land, is in Asia, where most of the aquaculture is coming from. And also, there's an incredible amount of blue in the sea there, so lots of fisheries catches as well. So this contrasts a lot, for example, with Africa, where aquaculture production is pretty low, but there are still fisheries production in the sea, and also places like Chile, where there's high wild fisheries, and actually a lot of that is being used in global markets of fish meal and oil to feed global aquaculture. Now, this is production, but actually we want to, in terms of food security and feeding the planet with an increasing population growth rate, we want to think about this production in terms of per capita availability. So one of our questions was whether fish supply is keeping up with human population growth. And when we look at this globally, in the recent 2016 FAO report, it was reported that per capita fish production is actually outpacing human population growth. But when you break that pattern apart in different countries across the world, what you can see is a really another patchy map. Okay, so here we've got in red percentage change in human population growth on land. You can see mostly orangey reds, that those are all increases. And in the sea, these are all of the compiled sources of fish production divided by the population. So the sources of fish production here are marine and inland fisheries and aquaculture that also account for the imports and the exports of the country. So it is it's an availability term. And you can see that there's a lot of blue on this map. These are decreases. So what we can see from this is that no, not all countries are actually keeping up with population growth. Now in the Indo-Pacific, you can see that this fish availability is actually outpacing human population growth. So red, much stronger than the orange on land. But there are a lot of blue patches around here. That means these patterns are, at least recently, over the past decade, declines in availability. And these can come from various sources. For example, if we focus on Chile again, this could be associated with falling catches, for example, or maybe the fact that the exports from Chile are extremely high. In terms of falling catches, brings us to the question of sustainability and what is ecologically sustainable. And of course, this is a hugely controversial topic, and the way in which you assess the sustainability of fisheries is highly controversial. I'm sure that Daniel could give a whole plenary on the different ways that this has been argued in the literature. But what we've done is compiled information on the proportion of stocks classified as overfished by the FAO. Now, these are only available in very broad regions. Now, for the globe as a whole, it's over 30% that are classified as overfished. But you can see that there are striking patterns on this map, which suggests in some places it's much higher. So I pointed to, I'm not picking on Chile, but I'm pointing to this area again, where you can see that this is actually one of the areas which has a much higher proportion of stocks that are classified as overfished. Now, that method doesn't actually allow us to get to the country level, so we can't really connect that with Chile or any other country here in South America very, very easily. There's also a lot of gray on this map, which is unknown. And of course, if we wanted to use the stock assessment database, for example, the RAM legacy database, that's missing an awful lot of the stock assessments, unfortunately, that have happened in recent years. So an alternative way of looking at ecological sustainability and biodiversity is to look at what the IUCN threat status data tell us. And one of the most comprehensively studied taxa are those for sharks and rays, a global database compiled by Nick Dalby and others. So we plotted that here in blue in the coast, and you can see that there is also this heterogeneity. Now, if we can pair that to what's happening on land, here we're also going to just look at another single taxa that are sensitive to land use change associated with agriculture and aquaculture. These are birds from the BirdLife database. You can see that their proportion of threatened species is much more widespread and also lower than that for sharks and rays. So what's this as an initial kind of exploration anyway, suggests that these impacts are more profound, at least at this stage, on land. Now finally, what we've compiled is multi-model mean ensemble projections for climate change, with those for fisheries and agricultural crops, which show that both fisheries and agriculture are projected to have a similar magnitude of impacts. Now, agriculture is often highlighted as having the most severe impacts of climate change. When we break these patterns apart at the country level, we can start to think about how we might pull together information on dependency on each sector to evaluate what might be done in terms of climate change. So for example, down here, we've got Barbados. It has impact from marine production, which is lower than that from crops. It has roughly equal dependency on both. So maybe there's room for some diversification there. But when you start adding in the threat data from biodiversity, it looks like there's pretty minimal room for maneuvering there. So we're caught between a rock and a hard place. A high degree of the threat in that area is coming from what's happening on land. So in summary, I think fish will continue to be an important source of food, nutrition, and livelihoods. I think it's unlikely that we're going to be doing massive global expansion of fisheries, and there's a lot more scope for aquaculture development, particularly with technological innovation for reducing impacts. And I think ultimately by bringing together information across sectors and understanding the interactions that we have across land and sea will help us to try to put forward plans for building climate resilience. And so on that note, I'll end the talk and thank you to the BES for having me here, as well as my co-authors and researchers from the Center of Marine Socioecology, where we'll be looking at this in a broader research context. Thank you.
We've got time for one question, if anyone wants to ask. We'll go with Catherine over there.
Okay, so this is a kind of first step at looking at a bunch of global databases, but we've looked at different indices of adaptive capacity, such as the Human Development Index, as well as these various dependency indices. Now, there's obviously a lot, there's, you know, mountains of information at the local and regional scale on people. And the work of our center is really, one of the main aims is to start putting those types of data and scientists who work on natural systems with social scientists together. So that's what we're kind of working hard on doing, but it's early days, so we've got a long way to go there.
Thank you. So next up, we have Axel Rosberg talking about how to achieve maximum sustainable yield from interacting fish stocks.
Well, thank you, Dom. Thank you, Guy. It's strange, I don't see anybody there. Yes, so it's about achieving maximum sustainable yield from interacting fish stocks. And it's a collaboration with Adrian Farkas from CIFAS. And to understand how to do this right, you have to first understand structural instability of ecological communities. That's the kind of theoretical concept. And and then we look at what this means for fisheries, and then we actually go and answer the question. Yeah, structural instability has been known for a while. And this is some papers here from Peter Jutzes, and this has been known even earlier. And whenever people try to build food web models, models of interacting species, they find these models are very sensitive to parameters. And it's very difficult to set them up that the resulting state is the state you see in nature. He investigated systematically, and he found that the long-term outcomes of press perturbations, that's important, press perturbations are highly indeterminate in all kinds of ways. And this has been investigated again and again, another paper here by Mark Novak, 2011, who also find system indeterminacy rapidly overwhelms predictive insights, in this case, as you add species to the system. So the phenomenon, this is structural instability of ecosystems or ecosystem models, and the phenomenon is known. I think it is only that in this book here by myself, where it explains why this is so. Why do we always see the structural instability in ecological communities? And I want to convince you that it's a universal phenomenon. Most ecosystems out there have this property, and they have it for a reason. And so I guide you slowly through the theory a little bit and how this works. Okay? So this is the Lotka-Volterra model, and all the interesting terms here are dropped. But the important thing is this interaction term here, the GIK. It's the matrix that couples interactions between different system species in the Lotka-Volterra model. And basically, I'm showing you a simulation of this Lotka-Volterra model. And the interesting thing is I add species to it one by one. Whenever I add a species, I set the diagonal element to one, and the other off-diagonal elements I choose randomly. And then I simulate, and when a species goes extinct, I remove it. And so I can have a fluctuating number of species in the system. And indeed, if I follow species regions in the system as I add species and species and species, I see a saturation of species regions. And then on average, with each species that I add, another one goes extinct. And in order to understand what's happening here, you have to go back to this Lotka-Volterra model, in particular this interaction matrix here, which is a sum over all k's. And look at the eigenvalues of this interaction matrix, not the Jacobian, of the eigenvalues of the interaction matrix. And what you see is as you add species to the system, the distribution of eigenvalues in the complex plane becomes broader and broader and broader, up to the point where the distribution touches to zero. And when it touches to zero, this is exactly the point where species richness here stops to increase. And indeed, because the distribution touches to zero, the system becomes structurally unstable, very, very sensitive to small perturbations, for example, the perturbation from one more added species. And it's sensitive to other perturbations too, just like changes in parameters or applying slightly different pressures. And communities cannot increase beyond the species richness because small changes in environment, small invasions, perturbations, will lead to extinctions. So they stop here. They stop at the edge of structural instability, you could say, where this cloud touches the zero. Now this is in a model. Question is, does it happen in reality? And the smoking gun for it happening in reality are graphs like this, where you plot the number of prey species in the ecosystem in one community against the number of predator species. And you see this consistent numerical ratios between one-third in some cases and one-half in other cases. And you see this in aquatic ecosystems, you see this in the terrestrial ecosystems, you see this all over. And the line of reasoning why this is so is a bit difficult, but it turns out if you go and read this book, here it is, buy it, you can read it from me, you will find that this is regression are explained by structural instability, and they're explained by nothing else. There is no other way to explain them. If you see this, it means these ecosystems you're looking at here have the structural instability property. I think it's amazing that people don't pick this up more. The structural instability has amazing explanatory power and is important for management as well, sure you know. So one of the implications of structural instability is the sensitivity to press perturbation, which means sensitivity to pressures. And if you want to manage the system using applying fixed pressures, you don't know what the outcome is, while you can try to manage it by targeting particular states, states that have the properties, give you the services that you want. So what I'm concluding then is you should do something like ecosystem engineering or gardening or whatever you want to call it. If you do ecosystem engineering, you get what you want. If you try to manage pressures, you will not. Okay, and now how about fisheries management? Well, here is this ICES is the International Council for the Exploitation of the Seas. It's the major organization organizing fisheries management in Europe, and they looked at ecosystem models, which means food web models of interacting species, and they find in all cases considered models are hard to calibrate, and there are uncertainties regarding parameters and outcomes related to external pressures, such as fishing mortalities, and they just recover what we knew already. These systems all have this property of structure and stability, and they have it for a reason, and there is nothing wrong with the models. It's just how nature is. Here's an example of this. It's one model which is fitted to past data, and it fits the past data pretty nicely, independent of how you do it. But if you then project in the future, you get completely different outcomes depending on model details. And then people conclude, well, these models are not good enough. We don't know how to interpret them. And so they fall back to using single species models. And of course, this is strange. I mean, the fact that you cannot understand very well these interactions between fish doesn't mean that you can simply ignore them, simply say, oh, each fish stock is there on its own and doesn't interact with the others. Of course they do interact, but we just have to be smart in taking these interactions into account. Okay, the proposal was manage for a state and not for pressure. And so we did this thing called we look at different strategies to manage for maximum sustainable yield, and we evaluate these strategies doing a management strategy evaluation. Now, what is this? It's a way of playing with computers and ecosystem models. You simulate the ecosystem together with the fisheries management. So you have two kinds of models. You have a model for the ecosystem itself, which is here the population dynamical matching model. You have another model, which is the model of the managers. And you assume these models are rational. However, the data that they use is not perfect, or the models that they use is not perfect. And based on these models, however, they make rational decisions and influence the ecosystem. And then you can model this interaction, and you can calculate what kind of yield you get from this simulation. And you can now play this game using different management strategies. So you can vary, in particular, if you want to have pressure targets, set pressure targets for fishing mortality or targets for the stock sizes, and you can also vary what kind of MSY you want to achieve here. We looked at three different kinds of objectives for MSY. One is what we call the Nash pressure objective, where it's similar to what people are doing at the moment. They only look at one stock and try to maximize the yield from the stock. Now, what they don't do is take into consideration that the yield of other stocks will also, the abundance of other stocks will also change. But you can do this. So you can say we sit together, each of us tries to maximize the yield from our own stock, but we listen to what other people are doing and so take this into account. And then you get, in the end, some state where there's Nash equilibrium, which is called, is reached. You could do something similar. You set together and try to choose the stock size. Each manager chooses the size of its own stock to maximize the yield from the stock, again, taking account what other managers are doing. It's called the Nash state objective. And then you can do the obvious thing is to try to maximize the total yield, for example, in biomass from the community. And this requires that you also talk together very carefully, collaborate, and adjust all the fleets and fishing pressures and abundances so that the total yield is the same. Problem with this is it requires lots of collaboration, and you will easily find there will be some stocks and some fleets which will be obvious losers and others which will be obvious winners, and so it's politically not so easy to do. And now we ran our management strategy evaluation, we played with our computers, see what the outcome is, And the most important thing is that indeed, as we predicted, with the pressure targets, if you try to set pressure targets and try to get much higher yield like this, the yield is always lower than with the state targets. And in particular drastic improvements you have here for the total yield objective. And indeed, if you go through the mathematics, you find that the total yield objective is particularly sensitive to structural instability. That's why you have a high improvement from going to, from pressure target to state targets. But you have it all through the different strategies. You also see that actually, with the Nash pressure objective, you don't come out so much worse than with the total yield objective. But the advantage of this, as I said, is it's politically more easy because it's essentially what people are doing at the moment already. And taking these into account, taking also into account what we see from the number of species that go extinct or go to very low abundance in these simulations, we concluded that this is the recommended thing to do. So it's a bit odd. You first define your target in terms of adjusting pressures and adjusting fishing mortalities that each stock on its own appears to be give you maximum yield. But then you convert this target state into biomasses and now manage in your year-to-year management to achieve these biomass targets rather than setting fixed fishing mortality targets. That's what I think is the way forward. That's what we are advocating now to the European Commission and the Parliament. And we hope that by 2035, that's what they're going to do. To wrap up, structural instability of ecological communities is real. It's out there. It's everywhere. It's an issue for any ecosystem management, not only fisheries management, but also for fisheries management in FMSY. And we recommend to manage for state targets rather than the pressure targets that the European fisheries managers are using at the moment. Thank you very much.
Any questions? No? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
So up next, we have Ken Anderson talking about, is fisheries management able to deal with stock recoveries? Ken.
Thank you. Yep. So fisheries management and fisheries science has to a large degree been shaped by the need to avoid overfishing. But what the question I want to ask here is whether we're actually able also to deal with recovery that we hope will be coming in the future. Well, let me start by looking at how we got there. And this is essentially a rephrasing a lot of the things that Daniel Pauli showed here in the morning, just a little different way. We have examples of collapses of large bodied fish stocks, and their collapse leads to a recovery or the increase in abundance of smaller forage fish. And you see that all the way down. So this is from the Northwest Atlantic. And if you look to our own backyard here, the North Sea, we see a similar thing. We have a time series here of the abundance of the biomass of species with different body size. And we see that the large-bodied species are going down and the small-bodied species are going up. This is based on size, but you will probably see a similar response if you look at average trophic levels. So this is what we have been dealing with historically. But there are signs that, at least in some and well-managed ecosystems, we're seeing signs that things are going differently. I've taken examples here from the North Sea. So this is from the most recent stock assessment from the International Council for the Exploration of the Sea. And on the left here, you see the fishing pressure, the fishing mortality. It has been high, and it's going down towards the fisheries reference points. When we do practical fisheries management, it's really about the reference points, and I'll talk more about them. And it's now going down towards the target reference points that gives the maximum yield. And we see that the biomass of the stock is responding. It's now going up, and it's approaching the target reference points. Place, another big stock in the North Sea,
we see a similar thing. Mortality goes down, and promptly the stock is responding quite a lot in this case here. And you have another example that's not the North Sea, that's the Iceland cod. Fishing mortality going down, and we see signs that the stock is going up. And these are just not small examples. I mean, these are really big stocks. This here is in thousands of tons. So we're talking millions, well, thousands of tons. So this is really a million ton. It's huge biomasses we're talking about here, and it's huge increases in absolute masses. There's, of course, still possibilities that this can go wrong. We can still screw it up, begin to get greedy and overfish these stocks before they reach a stable abundance again and a stable production capacity. But let's just, the question I want to ask now is, let's say this continues. Is management able to deal with the consequences of this? And to look at what will be the consequences of that, I'll need to return to some model simulation to simulate what will happen if this recovery continues. So I used a model based on body size of the entire ecosystem. So here I have everything from 10 grams up to 10 kilogram fish. And it's based upon the simple premise that if somebody has to grow and reproduce and maintain themselves, they have to do so by eating someone else. So somebody has to live, somebody else has to die. It's a simple balance that's in these marine ecosystems here. And I take that model and I fish it, and I fish everything with a high fishing mortality. This is what we have been doing, for instance, in the North Sea. So very high fishing mortality in everything. And this is what we get, a fairly flat distribution of the biomass with size, but very, very few big fish. Now let's see what happens if we begin to say, well, we actually successfully lower the fishing mortality on the big stocks, which is what seems to be happening. That's why I go here. So I simply lower the fishing mortality on those down to what we believe will give us the maximum sustainable yield, which are the current management targets. And what happens is not so surprising. Of course, these fish stocks goes up here by up to a factor of 5. And that has consequences because they need food. It has consequences for the smaller stocks that can go down in abundance by about a factor of 2. And that is, of course, a response to changes in predation mortality. The predation mortality on these smaller individuals here would go up by about a factor of 2. This will have consequences for the reference points that we use for management. We use 2 sets of reference points, as showed before, the fishing mortality that gives the target that we want, and essentially, we can say that they can support a certain mortality, a given stock. Part of it can be predation, and part of it can be fishing. So when predation mortality go up, the smaller stocks here can support a correspondingly smaller fishing mortality. So we have to adjust that fishing pressure down. And when there are fewer of them, and we can fish them less, we have to adjust ourselves that we can take much smaller yields of these species. This is a trade-off embodied in ecosystem-based fisheries management. So that gives us 3 challenges to science, is to be able to assess how these reference points change. One to fisheries management is to add in the ability for the reference points to be dynamic. Most often in management, these reference points live a hidden existence. We set them, and then we try to forget that how we actually set them and keep them constant, because it's really, really difficult to set reliable reference points. But here we clearly see that they need to be dynamic and change on an annual basis. And lastly, that's the same point that Axel raised. How do we deal with the redistribution of benefits from fishing the ecosystem between different fleets? The benefits of this fleet here, in terms of higher stocks and higher yields, will be paid by the fleet addressing these ones. How do we deal with that? But there's also challenges to the single species management. So fisheries management in practice is inherently a single species venture. We have different groups that looks at different stocks, and that's probably also how it's going to be in 2025, with good reasons, because each and every stock has its own quirks and special things that people need to know about particularly. But there's also changes in here, and here I've taken an example from a big ecological experiment called World War II. After that, the International Council of the Exploration of the Sea set down a working group and a symposium to explore what happened. And what happened was very common among all the stocks. Before the war, there was a low abundance, And then right after the war, we see huge increases in abundances of the stocks that was quickly fished down. But we also saw, so that's kind of the good part of the story, but we also saw another thing, namely here we have weight at age. And we saw that before the war, fish stocks grew rapidly to large sizes. But actually during the war, when the abundances were higher, well, they didn't grow so fast, obviously due to density-dependent competition for food. These things, density-dependent competition for food, is not taken into account in setting up the reference points at all, as it is currently. And if we do get continued increases in these stocks, we are going to see much more of these type of increases. Yeah, we need to deal with that. So, what I see is as the main challenges for practical fisheries management of places like the North Sea, the Baltic Sea, etc., is to get to grips with density-dependent regulation. And that's a hard question. It was, I mean, Darwin also even remarked on that. I mean, he struggled with one difficult question about what shapes the different species. But he knew about, of course, density-dependent regulation, and he called it the most obscure problem. And it is. It's very difficult to see density-dependent regulation from empirical series, and we struggle to deal with it in models. So density-dependent regulations has two forms. You have interspecific density dependence. What is when one fish stock or whatever increases in size, what is the impact on these smaller ones, for instance? And we have the interspecific density dependence. That was what we saw with the place. When they increase in abundance, to which degree does that reflect in increased competition and therefore slower growth? The first part, I mean, both of these goes in when we talk about ecosystem models. What is the balance between the interspecific density dependence and the interspecific density dependence? All of the ecosystem models that we use in fisheries management are very, very bad at dealing with this. And just for the record, that includes the model, my own model, that I showed results from here. That aspect is not satisfactorily dealt with. But the problem is that we are very bad at actually admitting to that problem and looking to how do we deal with it. We try to hide it away, not owning up to the problem, or we try to put a lot of fancy ecological mechanisms into it and say, well, these are what regulates it, but it's really not well controlled. Or we build very, very complicated model where we try to add every single effect in there, and in fact, then drowning the most important part, namely how do we model the density dependence in a lot of noise that really doesn't matter so much. And the other thing is how to deal with the interspecific density dependent, the changes in growth due to recovering stocks. In fact, a few weeks ago, ICES was formally asked to figure out what are the consequences of the huge increases in the mackerel stock and the changes in growth for the reference points. And ICES basically had to turn the request down and say, we don't know, we don't have the science to deal with it. So these, I think, are hopefully the problems that we will have to deal with in fisheries management in the next 10 years. And I also think this is an important lesson to learn for where fundamental ecology has something to give to fisheries management and fisheries science. We need ecologists to go in and understand these things better and go in and feed it into the actual management process, for instance, in ICES, to deal with this in the future. So with that, I'll just say thank you for your attention. No, I disagree. I don't think we have any models that reliably can deal with the difference or the balance between interspecific density-dependent processes and, well, intraspecific density-dependent processes. Maybe we do a good job, but I don't think we have any way of knowing whether it's good. What we do at the moment, we don't know.
Any other questions? Yeah.
Just formulating this question, but just thinking, because
Partly. I mean, we can actually, when we forget about species and just talk about trophic levels or size or something, we can actually do something which I think is a little bit more robust. And we also do that. The model I showed was one of a way to deal with that. But fisheries management is inherently about the species. We want to have the cod on the table. We don't want necessarily another species. So we have to be able to deal with this also on a species by species basis. That's not going away.
Yeah, okay, one more.
I don't think that affects the ability to recover very much. I mean, certainly we have strong selection of fish stocks. We want to take the biggest one, and that has an evolutionary response. We are, in a sense, doing an unnatural evolution on the fish stocks. But I think that signal and those changes are still at the effect where they're much smaller than the very, very strong direct ecological effects that we're seeing. These are the ones that was happening during the war, for instance. And these are on the shorter timescale, the one that we are primarily dealing with at the moment.
Cool. Thank you.
So now we have our final talk in the session from Katie Longo, talking about more complexity, more problems, incentives to meet future fisheries sustainability challenges. So over to you, Katie.
Hi, everyone. I wanted to thank the session organizers because Guy and Dominic, I think it's been a really interesting session so far. I really enjoyed all of the talks. And this is going to be a bit of a departure because this is coming more from a perspective of a user of a lot of the scientific topics that you've heard about so far. I work from the Marine Stewardship Council that has been mentioned earlier this morning. So I'm going to start off with a paper that Andrea mentioned earlier. Andrea and I worked among other people on this, and this was a paper focusing on the use of traffic indicators to implement the ecosystem approach and looking at progress so far. But in the conclusive part of this paper, we were looking at what are all the different ways in which the ecosystem-based management and ecosystem approach has been articulated and all the different issues that have come up. I don't really want you to look at this diagram in great detail. This was a back of the envelope exercise of laying out there all of the different issues that have come up and thinking about their shared traits are that they all require looking at more dimensions than we have before and highlighting a lot of different ways in which this is important. So thinking about climate change and uncertainty and needing to assess more species than we have done before and more interactions. And in particular, thinking about the interaction between the human and the ecological dimension that Julia has also touched on. So this is why the talk is titled More Complexity, More Problems. And I think one of the key challenges in implementing and operationalizing these ideas is that there's a need for more information and more knowledge gathering, more understanding, and also bringing together people that don't necessarily like working together, are not used to working together, and have to come up with shared agreements and don't necessarily look as smiley as they did in one of Axel's slides. So what I wanted to reflect on in this talk is how eco-labeling, and in particular the Marine Stewardship Council, has in a way been an incentive to go the extra mile and take these steps to collect that extra information and to gain that additional learning and deal with all these complex needs that come from trying to implement ecosystem-based management. So for those of you who are not familiar with the Marine Stewardship Council, it's an international non-for-profit NGO, and it's a standard setter, which means that we set the requirements that help identify whether fishery is sustainable, and it also has a chain of custody standard in order to ensure that those who trade seafood with the label actually are trading seafood that comes from the certified fisheries. And this means that we set the requirements, but it's a third-party certification scheme, which means we do not do any of the assessments. And that map shows distribution of the currently certified fisheries. So the challenge when MSC set out to create this standard was the idea of operationalizing what is the international guidelines in the FAO Code of Conduct for Responsible Fisheries. And a key challenge there is starting from wanting to come up with requirements that are scientifically credible and robust and that are clear and applicable to any fishery around the world, but also can be applied in practice and importantly that are auditable, which means that a third party certifier can take them and interpret them in an unambiguous way. Because if that doesn't happen, that leads to a lot of problems. And some of those problems have come up and have been dealt with along the way. MSC has now released the third version of its standard, and we're working on a next version. So the way that the fishery standard was structured in order to create these requirements was around three principles. So what I'm showing here is the assessment tree, and the important part are those blue boxes that show the three core principles around which the standard is structured. So principle one is looking at the health of stocks, so the stocks that are being certified, and principle two is looking at the ecosystem impact, so the indirect effects on endangered and threatened and protected species, on habitats, on non-target species, on ecosystem functioning, and a lot of the things that have been talked about during this session. And the third principle is looking at the structure of the management and governance of how the fishery is managed, how the harvest controls rules are set, etc. So those rectangles that you see below each of those three blue boxes are indicators that are used to evaluate whether each of those principles are being achieved, and there is a scoring system. And the scoring system awards a 60 as a minimum pass, and it's a conditional pass because 80 is considered best practice. So if a fishery scores a 60 for any of those criteria that I showed earlier, they need to make a time-bound commitment to go and meet best practice within 5 years, so within the certification cycle. Otherwise, they cannot maintain certification. And that is a way of achieving this principle of continual improvement and of creating that incentive for fisheries that meet the bar but barely meet the bar to actually all come at best practice. And there's only a certain limited number of criteria for which they can be at minimum pass, otherwise they will fail. So looking at some of the examples of how the eco-labeling has worked in terms of incentivizing gathering information, I'm going to show you a couple of histograms from a study that we're currently writing up. It's looking at the kind of actions that fisheries have done in order to what we call closing the conditions. That means fulfilling that time-bound commitment in order to keep their certification. So these were all fisheries that were found to be have a minimum pass for their impact on habitats or on bycatch species and needed to do something in order to be considered a best practice. I'm not going to read in detail all of those words. I don't even have my glasses on, so I can't see any of them. But also, I would love you to read the paper when it comes out, so there's a lot more interesting information in that. But I think one key message here is if you look at the histogram to the right that's showing some of the things that were done in order to do impact assessments and research to look at whether there was some kind of impact. And a lot of these were trawler fisheries, and that was why they had to do this extra work in order to demonstrate that they were best practice. So the higher columns are all about mapping effort and mapping habitats. So effectively, what happened as an effect of these conditions was that more fundamental ecological information was collected This is a collection of about 80 fisheries, so the stories behind how each of these came about are really different. In some cases, there were things that they were already doing anyway because management had changed, management requirements forced them to do that. In other cases, so this was just a recognition of that. In other cases, instead, they had to kind of scramble to do something in order to keep their certificate. Another recent example that also involves WWF that Daniel Pauly mentioned this morning, and I think is an example of how there are these complex interactions between stakeholders, is the Maldives skipjack tuna in the Indian Ocean. So we know that tuna fisheries, fisheries in high seas and RFMOs have complex political situations, difficult data, a lot of data uncertainty, issues with models. And one of the problems have to do not just with the science, but with the people, getting people together to agree. And so the minimum pass that the Maldives fisheries got was for their harvest control rules that were there, but were not well-defined. And so the standard requires that they come up with well-defined fisheries, but they have to apply at the stock level. And they are pull in line fishers that fish on a small part of the stock, so they had to get all the other countries in the organization to agree to come up with these well-defined harvest control rules that had to be MSC tested and that had to be specific. And this was also a particular case because it was a case of a fishery that was not in danger, was not a fishery that was heavily depleted, but because there are these written requirements to meet best practice, they had to come up with something anyway. And this long, wordy statement is not something that you necessarily have to read in full, but I just highlighted it because it was part of our press release and it illustrates how many different stakeholders got involved. So there were retailers that were making statements about not sourcing seafood from that stock anymore if these harvest control rules weren't put in place, and WWF got involved. They were heavily involved in the fisheries improvement plan for the Maldives. MSC helped organize the meeting, and the IPNLF was representing Maldives fisheries. So it just forced a lot of people to get in the room and do something that usually doesn't happen in RFMOs. Another example has to do with operationalizing these difficult requirements of having to account, for example, for impacts on ecosystem functioning. And that is in itself a scientific problem. And it's also difficult to set an auditable criteria that can be applied worldwide. So this is supposed to be P2. So P2 is a principle, 2 is on ecosystem functioning. So one of the rules that are in the standard now are on low trophic level species. They were based on research that came out in 2010 and 2011. There was a science paper by Smith et al., and there was also a Lenfest report that came out in 2011. The way this was included in the standard was looking at which were the species that can be considered low trophic level and that should be looked at for this requirement. And then coming up with some criteria to decide whether they are key species, so whether they require additional attention. And so the first requirement is that they are highly connected within the food web. The second one is that there's an important part of the energy that flows through this stock. And the third one is that the structure of that food web is wasp-waisted, so that that species has a key role that is not replaceable by other species in that trophic level. So these are extremely technical pieces of information that come from ecological science. And once one identifies whether those are key trophic level species, and krill, for example, is one of them. And as Daniel mentioned earlier this morning, krill is one of those species that for which there is an ecosystem model. Where MSC has certified fisheries based on whether the fishery leaves enough biomass at sea for other predators, although there are different opinions on whether that is sufficient or not. So based on that, for species that are identified as low trophic level species that are key, then there's the harvest strategy needs to take a very precautionary approach. And unless there is a specific knowledge based on models and the burden of proof is on the and the fisheries and on the assessors to have these thresholds. So in this case, it's 75% of virgin biomass, or a harvest rate that's 50% of FMSY, unless there's a specific knowledge for that model. And for all the trophic level species that don't fulfill these criteria, then there's a regular tree that is used. So this was to give you a sense of how, based on what we have observed, MSC has played a role in forcing fisheries to collect additional information or to lobby for that to become part of regular monitoring programs and to make stakeholders that don't usually work together come together, and also to think about ways of using science as it comes out and becomes available to come up with operational targets. But this session is about what are the future challenges. And I think some of the key issues that we need to deal with have to do with the social dimension, because there's an increasing awareness that we can't narrowly focus on environmental sustainability. And the other aspect is dealing with data-limited assessments, because we can't just assess species for which we have formal stock assessments. As Julia has illustrated earlier when she was talking about the proportion of stocks for which we don't have information, and also Dana Polly's work on reconstructions and years of information has shown how there is so much information that is missing, and there are so many stocks that are being fished for which we don't have a good understanding. So a lot of the work we're doing right now is focusing on guidance for assessing data-limited stocks, using a risk-based framework for ecosystem requirements, thinking about mixed fisheries, and thinking about social dimensions such as forced labor and indirect effects. And I don't know how many seconds I have left. Oh, okay. Well, I think I covered everything. So, but if you have more questions about other things that I have not covered, please come and find me.
Thank you. Yeah, we've got time for some questions. Okay. Yep. If anyone wants to. Any questions? Yep.
So the MSC claim has evidently been very successful since many stocks are now being assessed and the public opinion seems recognized as such. But of course, inevitably, also some stocks will be assessed by ones as well that may be important.
Well, I think that the crux of that is always having these different organizations that pull in different directions. That's kind of what keeps the healthy balance. So having WWF, that even though they are one of the founders, they're also ones that are always bringing up issues of concern that have to do with more conservation-oriented issues. And there's also social issues that are coming to the fore as well that don't necessarily align even with the conservation ones. So I think having this healthy discussion between stakeholders, and also MSC has a really elaborate system. So that diagram just shows all the different steps for certification. There's a lot of elements of stakeholder input, and I think that's part of what helps not balance too much on one side. At the end of the day, our currency is the credibility. So if people stop believing that it's scientifically robust, or if when something happens that's a loophole that makes it through the cracks that we hadn't thought of, and we don't fix it, then we'll lose the ability to do more work. So, yeah. That is a very interesting question. Well, so there's a couple of initiatives that are trying to align different organizations. A lot of them aren't actually proper eco-labels, and MSC is the only one that has a supply chain standard associated with the label as well. So instead of just saying this fishery is good, but saying this product you have in your hand is actually coming from that fishery, is still something that only MSC has. But yeah, that is a very complex world. We're, for example, involved in advising IFO, which are certifying processors, so it's a business-to-business eco-label, but trying to get them to meet those low traffic level requirements. So thinking about all these big processors that are sourcing, and also linking up with the aquaculture stewardship council in these mixtures of how where they source their feed for the certified stocks, and that also links up to IFO as well. So I think the idea, especially coming from the big NGOs that want to fund these organizations, is for all these different organizations to align together and create a clear pathway on what aspects of sustainability each covers, because otherwise it kind of defeats the purpose if it's so confusing that you don't know what's the claim attached to each. I don't know if that answered your question. I guess I answered by saying we're thinking about it.
So thank you very much for attending our session today. If you're interested in aquatic ecology, which I guess you all are because you're here, please do come along at 7 o'clock this evening for the Aquatic Ecology Special Interest Group Social. Just meet by the registration desk. And then I'd just like to say thank you to the BES for allowing us to have this session here, and special thanks to all our speakers to agreeing to come here and speak today. So thank you.
I'd just like to add a couple of quick words. So again, thanks very much to the speakers for coming today. And just to reiterate what Dom says, you're more than welcome to come to the BES Aquatic Group social event. It'd be great to get much more representation from the fisheries angle here in particular, because I know that there's been a little bit of a disconnect over the years with the BES. So the stronger the representation, the better. So thanks again for a great set of talks, and please come along and meet the other aquatic ecologists who are amongst us. Thank you.